twisted, you've been out of shape, and you feel like you've missed it. You dropped out the race, and as time flies by, you'll open up your eyes wide. You feel it's gonna go your way.
Welcome back to Marbella Now. My name is Nicole King, and this week's program is going to be busier than ever. So many great guests, but we're starting off from a really cool new art gallery that's opened up in La Quinta. It's called Benezra Gallery. Let's take a look.
You know it's gonna go your way.
We're at the Benezra Gallery, and it belongs to Maureen and Lawrence Benezra. And the first time I met this fabulous couple was at one of Teresa Bernabe's Blow Your Mind garden parties, and they were so nice to me, and I kind of loved you from then on, because it's a big world out there. There's so many things happening in Marbella, yes. And you in particular are dedicated to the world of art. You are art critiques, art
consultants.
Yes.
So tell us a bit about, before we get into this, congratulations on this amazing new gallery. Tell us a bit about what brought you to this point.
We've been here for around 6 years, and we've enjoyed it very much. We've met lots of people during that period of time, and we've got the private clients and collectors and people that are just excited to see something new. So it happened quite suddenly, actually, about 6 weeks ago, and we saw this space, and it's a beautiful building, and it's very different for Marbella. And I think we were probably waiting for something different to come along.
Yes, it was quite a sort of not a wake-up call, but it was something very special for us. And although we've been sort of half looking for gallery space, this just came up as a coincidence. And as soon as we saw it, we just fell in love with the tranquil setting of the courtyard and the beautiful space that there is here to display beautiful pieces of art. So hence we're here today.
Maureen, what's your vision here?
The vision here is that this is in an unusual setting. It's not bang in the middle of the high street anywhere. So a lot of it will be destination and recommendation. And also it's just a lovely place to be. People can come in and have a look. There will be absolutely no pressure. We will give them lots of information about the artist if they want it. And there are lots of stories behind each artist. So I particularly enjoy that part of the process. And we just want people to feel welcome and come in here and have a look. We will have lots of different things all the time.
Lawrence, the gallery is, the whole concept and everything together is super, but you have different artists, such different styles. How do you choose them?
With great difficulty. It's not something that we we think about too much, funny enough. But when we see something, we absolutely fall in love with the work and with the artist, and also the character of the artist as well, because that displays in the pieces of art. So I think we buy or we collect for what we like and what we perceive that the public would like, or certain sectors of the public would enjoy to have on their wall at home. Also for investment reasons too. So we tend not to have, shall we say, bread and butter art, but important pieces of art that people can enjoy and they would have some appreciating value too.
Well, the nice thing is, Maureen, you can come into, as you were saying, a place like this, and you're saying that people are welcome. I think sometimes people feel that if they're not going to buy something, they shouldn't be in. But it's a nice way to actually spend some time. The area is fabulous.
Yes, it is.
This lady's artwork behind us was when I saw you last time.
Yes, it's Katerina, and Katerina lives in Ireland, but she's... was in Marbella last year, and Marbella fell in love with her.
Mexican.
Yeah, she is Mexican, but she lives in Ireland, and she's very special. She looks like her paintings, and her work is very beautiful, so we decided to give her more space here. She's in London as well. We placed her in a gallery in London, which is brilliant, and I hope she'll visit soon.
Lawrence, you're talking about important artwork. As of how much is a piece of artwork like this? Because we think... Big money, we're in Marbella. Is it really that big money?
Not necessarily. Again, art is in the eye of the beholder. So you can have a piece for 500 or 1,000 euros. Somebody would love it as much as a Picasso for 50 million. If they have a passion and a feeling for that piece, an enjoyment for that piece, it doesn't really matter in that respect.
Well, it's a really very soothing atmosphere.
You can hear the water outside.
It's got the patio is gorgeous. In fact, the whole thing is lovely. It's a very comfortable feel. We are very privileged because Maureen and Lawrence have arranged for some of the artists to actually be here with us so we can have a chat with them and get their take on how they feel, because the artworks are all so different.
They are. Yes. It's an eclectic mix, but it all works beautifully together.
It does, as do you two.
Oh, thank you very much.
You're really that dynamic duo. You're a lovely couple.
thank you
so much, because
it's
our 99th programme, but it's thanks to survival, like people like Lawrence and Maureen. Alithia is also exhibiting here at the gallery. Where are you from, Alithia?
I am originally from Poland, even I live longer in Spain than in Poland, but this is my birth, this is when I grow up and in Poland. And live in Spain most of my life.
So Spanish is easier for you than English, I'm sure.
Spanish is easier for me at this moment than Polish.
It's lovely that we all settle in here. Your style is very unique. What inspires you, Alithia?
Freedom of expression, because as you see, this is my abstract work, but I am very good in realism. I dominated it very much. But this was the point that I couldn't, I had to liberate from the form. And I study a lot of metaphysics and the energy world, so and evolution, so I feel like the liberation of the form, so liberation of the realism, it closed me, it's kind of jail to draw something very specific, very closed in a form. So now they are not form, they are just energy freely circulated, freely moving.
Well, it's fabulous, because to see you and to see your artwork, it's lovely to see that really it is your growth and your expression saying enough, let's just...
It's freedom of expression, freedom of everything, and freedom of forms, because forms, drawing is always a form, and then it's like in a jail, as I say, and this form, this energy fly and make free forms, not established, not something. So actually many of my painting, even if it's abstract, but has a lot of new expression, a lot of new forms, and is telling sometimes more than a subject it is drawing realistically, because often you have a different reading. You see something one day, then later you can see something else. is like aliveness. It's more aliveness and more expression in this forms and this abstract than in realism, where they have only one one image and one expression.
Each artist is so different in their expression, but you have to come and see Alithia's. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank
you. Hey, hey, it's a brand new day. Hey, 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 it's a brand new day.
Marie Faye is one of those privileged artists to be at the first exhibition here at the Benezra Gallery. Good morning.
Good morning.
I love the colours in your pieces. They are beautiful.
Thank you.
Where are you from, Marie Faye?
I'm from Cordoba, but I live in Marbella since 1987.
Wow, so you're a true Marbella.
Yeah, I am.
And how long have you been painting?
Well, I've been painting all my life. But when I started to really try hard and exhibit in big galleries around the world, it's been from 2010. Before, I had small exhibition, but I'm a graphic designer as well, and I try to combine both.
Well, your artwork certainly is combining different techniques. What do you base on your style?
I use photography, and my style is always based on an idea. Then, as I want to express a story, I use everything I know, like photography. I'm a photographer, I'm a designer, and I'm an artist, I'm a painter. Then I use the different technique to tell that story.
Well, they're beautiful stories. I wish you best of luck, Marie Faye. Thank you
very much.
Life's waves shifted, falls in place.
Sarah Fitzgerald is also exhibiting here at the Benezra Gallery. And I love bling. And this artwork is bling, but it's not bling. And apparently a lot more to it, Sarah, than that. Hi, nice to meet you.
Hi, nice to meet you too. Thank you for the interview. Yes, it's a little bit of bling. I love beautiful, shiny things, but this has got a little bit of a serious note to it. It's a magical thing. I've found that I take a lot of photographs, and these white circular objects are on the photograph, and I was getting so many of them that I investigated it a little bit and found out what they are. And they are apparently angelic beings that move amongst us, and I wanted to honor them in my work, and so I've done a series of orb paintings, and this is the first one of them.
So this is like the culmination of these things that appear in your pictures.
Yes.
Was that a frustration for you? So are you a photographer? Where did your expression develop from?
I love taking photographs. I love anything visual, really, but as they were appearing a lot in my photographs, at first I thought my camera was broken, and then I looked at it a bit more and I went into it, and I discovered this phenomena, and so I thought I should paint them. Really.
Are you a spiritual person?
I am a very spiritual person, and I wanted to bring it to the attention of people so that they can look and see, oh yes, actually I've got a few in my photographs. And so I wanted to illustrate that with this work.
Literally.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Sarah. It's lovely meeting you.
Lovely
sure, we'll see
to
a lot
meet
more
you too.
You.
Thank you very much.
You'll open up your eyes wide. You know it's gonna go.
The variety of the style of the artwork is tremendous, and each one is amazing. Michelle, how lovely to meet you.
Lovely to meet you.
Where are you from?
Australia, but I'm actually quite a nomadic person, so I'm living sometimes in Australia and sometimes here.
What's it like? It must be very different, Marbella and Australia.
Well, that's why I love it here. It's very, very warm and very emotional, and it's full. It's a full feeling when you're living here.
Yeah, and Australia's so big, and we're
it's
so tiny.
It's very big. It's very big, and it's got very few people where I live, and it's still both very, very hot, but the people are warmer.
How long have you been here?
Probably about now 6 months.
So you're really very new. Well,
very
welcome.
New. Thank you. It's lovely to meet you.
It gets better as you go along.
Yeah, I need to learn some Spanish. Well, that would be the best.
Well, I'm sure that you will, because you're already so successful. This whole wall was covered in Michelle's artwork, but the only three left, well done, are the three behind us. We must feel very proud.
Well, I was thrilled. I mean, you know, we've got, the gallery was open, and then we have experts who are selling the work. And actually, funnily enough, when I came in here, I knew by the way they curated it that I was dealing with professionals, because they have a different, very eclectic bunch, but they've managed to make it all feel comfortable, and the mood is perfect.
So you definitely had a good move by coming here.
It was a really good move.
Well, it's lovely to meet you, Michelle. I wish you best of luck.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Before we leave the Benezra Gallery and say again thanks to Lawrence and Maureen for inviting us, it's been a lovely experience. How lucky to meet the architect and the
engineer
of this amazing building.
Yes, we tried to make something a little bit different than the rest. It's not only the design, it's also the materials that we use. It's everything is concrete, not bricks at all, no rendering. Everything is like with its own skin, you know.
Are there any spaces left?
Well, there are two spaces on the top that we are reserving. We don't know if we are going to rent it now. We just leave it because we love it, the two spaces on the wooden box on the top.
You found a perfect home for yourself.
Yeah, I know.
Well, that's what happens when you do something so great. If I was a painter, I'd never be able to sell anything. I want to keep it all for myself.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Lovely to meet you. Guys, congratulations. Okay. I mean, already selling and you just opened.
Yes, thank you
perfect.
Very much,
Come you. And visit the Benezra Gallery here in La Quinta.
Hey, it's a brand new day.
Just 2 minutes down from La Quinta, and we're back here in Nueva Andalucía. And we've come today to a bar called The Local. It's a lounge bar where you can come and play games, backgammon, Connect Four, you can watch the sports, and a lovely place to hang out, particularly with the winter months coming in. The owners and the guys that run it are sons of a very good friend of mine from way back when, Fiona Wiggs. Let's go take a look.
Hey, it's a brand new day.
It's always a pleasure to come somewhere where you know the people. Particularly, I've known Fiona since we were both teenagers here in Marbella. You got married here, you've had kids here,
yep.
They've grown up here.
Absolutely.
And yep. We were saying one of the nicest things is about bringing children up in Spain is that they're grown up now, but they still like their mummy. It's like,
aren't I
the big
a
plus
lucky
of
girl?
The Spanish input.
Know that the
families are close and...
Yes, we are, yeah. They're both good boys, they're both decent human beings.
And they're both single, and they are gorgeous. So, Fiona, you brought us here today. The boys, the babies, have opened up their own place. It's called The Local.
Yeah.
And what a great place to hang
Super,
out for any age.
Yes.
At first I thought it was for youngsters only.
It's really relaxed. It's open all day. They opened for special events as well, but I'm sure my sons will tell you about that later. Basically it's off the beaten track a little bit, but it's really laid back and cool. It's brilliantly decorated. It's in a really good place.
Which one of you is the older brother? Okay, so Alexis works for you. Sebastian, big brother. When did you get the idea to open up your own place?
Oh, it came quite a while back, actually, but I was waiting for the funds. As soon as the funds came in, then I went ahead looking for the location, found this unit, which was a friend of mine that was getting rid of it, so jumped on the back of that. And from there, it was just working everything out, getting everything how it should be. Architects, construction, you know how it is in Spain, so everything's very slow. And it's a great area. It's picking up now, so, you know, lots of parking space, so
The design is amazing. It's beautifully decorated. Who is in charge of that?
Well, 50-50, really. I mean, I left a bit of it up to the designers, and then a lot of it, yeah. I mean, the graffiti was a good...
Did you paint it, or you got someone to do it for you?
I helped out. I didn't do the whole thing.
Okay. So you got artists.
I added to it.
But from London, wasn't it, who came?
Slovakian friend. Yeah, he worked in a bar that I know, and just went ahead with that, really.
It's a really great place to be, particularly safe for me. I'm not one to go out drinking, but you don't always want to be at home. The nice thing here, Alexis, is you've got backgammon, Connect Four. There's so much to do apart from watching sports.
Yeah, we have loads of little like table games that you can play. We've got like the Jenga, and as she mentioned, backgammon, chess, and other little board games, card games, keep you entertained. Every now and then, some of our friends throw like a poker like little tournaments in here between them. They just play for fun. So there's lots of little games that go on here apart from the live sports that we have and the great shishas and the teas that we've got going.
And tell them about the America, what the new connection you've got with the boxing game.
Oh yeah, well, apart from all the sports, we do live events. For instance, this weekend, Saturday night, we have the big Conor McGregor fight in America, which is in New York, which we stay open late for. And we do other live events and sporting events like that. So we keep ourselves entertained and we keep you entertained.
Which is the idea. Seb, you don't actually serve food here, it's drinks, shishas. What's your normal opening times? And you have a great relationship with your neighbours if people do get peckish.
Yes. Well, we open from 11 a.m. in the morning until late. I mean, our timetables change all the time. I mean, I'm very flexible. Normally, the license is till 2 a.m. in the morning. But as my brother just said, for the Conor McGregor fight, we'll be open till 6, 7, 8 o'clock for that one. And if we have clients here that are having drinks and having fun, I don't mind staying till 3, 4, 5 in the morning. So, I mean, our license caters to everything. As being a cafeteria, we're allowed to open very extensive hours, late, early, so it works out quite good for us.
Well, I have to say it works out good for all of us because it really is very convenient. Nueva Andalucía next to the H10, Terrasana one side, you've got Palomera Milada, so there's a lot of places to come to this area. But when you are here, to come and hang out here, as I said, for me it's been a godsend, somewhere to come play backgammon and sit comfortably. Best of luck.
Thank you
very much for hosting. Any last minute messages to our viewers? Apart from come and visit.
Yeah, of course. Come and visit us. Come and try out the shishas. We've got great coffee, great teas, as my brother said as well. And yeah, we've got all the sporting events. And if there's anything you would like, you can check us out on Facebook. It's The Local Banus. And you can always call us and ask about any sporting events that you'd like to watch, and we'll put it on for you because we've got everything.
Wonderful. And if they want to do special events, you're open for that too, right, Alexis? Yeah. They can just contact for that.
Contact us, as my brother said, through Facebook and or through our telephone numbers, email addresses, and we'll cater for all your needs.
And the most important thing is come check it out. They're really fun guys. And well, obviously coming from Wild Fiona.
Wild Fiona, that's really.
Thanks so much for letting us host our program here. It's been a lot of fun.
Anytime.
Pleasure.
Good afternoon. Here we are again, this time in Nueva Andalucía, in a beautiful little Irish place. It's called Local. And today I have with me a tiny little puppy, as you can see. Let me hold her up, because otherwise you might not be able to see her. Or him, actually. This is little Patch. Patch was one of six brothers and sisters, again found in a garbage bag inside a garbage bin. They were only about 4 weeks old when they came to us, and they were very skinny, and we weren't quite sure if they were going to make it. But we took care of them with a lot of love and a lot of good food, and they survived. So little Patch at the moment is just over 2 months. As you can see, it will be a tiny little doggy, very quiet, very peaceful. I'm not quite sure exactly what he's going to be like, but I think it's a bit borreguero. Maybe a little bit of Chihuahua, but I'm not quite sure. So they are for adoption at the moment because they're over 2 months old. So you can come to AAA if you want to see them and get to know them and maybe adopt them. About adoptions for puppies at the moment, of course, we have a lot of puppies that came in the last little while, and most of them are available. However, I must warn you, because Christmas is coming up and everybody knows puppies are adorable, they're very loving, very kind, very sweet, and they make wonderful Christmas presents. However, they don't. We do not want puppies to be Christmas presents. From our experience, we've noticed a lot that people, and especially children, are crazy about little puppies. But the children do not realize what it means to take care of a puppy. They really see them as little toys and very adorable toys, but they're not. They grow up, they get older, they need care, they need a lot of attention. They poo, they pee, as I always say puppies do, in the house until they're trained. And from experience again, we do get puppies back after Christmas because people did not realize that it was not just a nice present, but it was a gift for life, at least for the life of the dog. 15 years, if all goes well, the dogs will be part of your family. And we always do want that to be the only way for the doggies, to be part of the family and stay there for as long as it is their life. So between the 15th of December and the 15th of January, we will not be giving, or we will not be able to have you adopt puppies. Bigger dogs, yes, but not as a present, of course. So if you want a puppy in that time, you can definitely come and have a look at it and get to know the puppy and choose one, but you have to reserve it and we'll come for it after January. And I hope you understand, because we do anything and everything for the protection of the dogs and specifically the puppies, because they are so depending on us. As you can see, this little baby, he will not be able to survive with our care. So please consider adopting from AAA. An older dog would be fantastic as well, because still got many of them. And I hoped you enjoyed the story, the good luck story of Coco and Harry last week. Two little Goldie oldies, they were over 10 years old already, but they were adopted, they went to Switzerland and are having a wonderful time there in a private home for the last little while that they have to live. So please consider adopting. Do not buy, because as I warned you before, specifically now, a lot of puppies will be brought to the stores and not all of them are healthy, not all of them have been vaccinated, and not all of them come with a healthy guarantee. Come to AAA if you want a healthy dog. Come to AAA if you want a sweet dog. Come to AAA to adopt. And please consider AAA as well. Become a member. Only €5 a month you can become a member. We do need your support. We are not getting any support from the government. So financially, we have to look after nearly 600 animals. So please consider becoming a member. Virtually adopt a dog. Come to AAA to physically adopt a dog. And remember this time again, don't shop, adopt. See you next week.
The best way to talk about what someone does is when you've actually tried what they do. And in this instance, I had the most amazing different massage of my life with Valeria a week ago.
Yes.
I still feel energized. Normally we have a massage, you finish like, oh, all groggy. I was going to the Mind, Body and Spirit Festival afterwards, and yet it was the opposite. I felt so alive and so invigorating. So first of all, thank you.
You're welcome.
Valeria, explain, what is your speciality? Because that was quite different than what I was expecting.
I'm an Ayurvedic practitioner, and also I do all sorts of Ayurvedic body treatments. And the massage I gave you, what we do is actually is move your prana, your chi, your energy. And that's why I'm sure you remember I did a lot of circular movements from all the way from your feet all the way to your head. And also we use a lot of oil, and all that oil goes into massage and takes toxin out. And then when you shower, that toxin just goes right out of your body.
Well, it was a very relaxing massage, but unusual than anything before. I kept on finding I was opening my eyes all the time. And it was, I actually felt relaxed.
But also rejuvenated.
But rejuvenated. It was a very strange feeling. How did you get involved? How did you know about this type of thing?
Well, I own a yoga studio in Vancouver. I've been teaching yoga for about 12 years. And after each class, students come up to me and ask me all sorts of problems, like how can I help them, how can I fix them? And of course, I couldn't. So I decided to study Ayurveda, and I also had my own personal problems. And with Ayurveda, I've been studying it for over 5 years now. It also led to learn some therapies.
And Ayurveda, what does that mean? What is that exactly? You say Ayurveda, it's a something. It must be, what is it, a speciality?
It's a science of life. It's a sister science of yoga. It originated from India. And what we do is actually, we try to prevent the disease. So we don't let people get diseased, we help them before.
So it's recommendable, you don't have to be poorly or you don't have to hurt somewhere to do this type of treatment, is something just to keep you, I suppose, in the right vibration?
Because you talked about preventative, yes.
Energies, chakras. Explain a bit how that works in our body, our energies of the body.
Well, we all have all sorts of subtle energies too, and most people are not even aware of that, right? And what we do is this type of massage removes them. So if you have some kind of stuck energy in your body anywhere, we make it move.
And what stops that energy? What are the things that happen in our day to day that tend to block those energies?
Bad type of lifestyle. We all do some things that we know we shouldn't and we're still doing them. It's okay. And then you build up blockage in all sorts of areas. And you usually build up blockage where you're the weakest part of your body. And for everybody, it's somewhere else.
People want to come and visit you, have a consultation, do treatments. You're based in an amazing location. Tell us about where you're living and where you do your treatments, because it's quite unique.
I base my business out of Benahavis, and I really find that area amazing because it has such a healing energy. It's really tucked
the
in between mountains.
Out of this world.
The view is amazing, the energy, you can just feel the energy there. Like you go out and you just feel so good.
But you had a table that had like a oil dripping thing on it.
That's the Shirodara, when I pour oil on your third eye and it's dripping for about an hour. That's an ultimate relaxation. You should try that next time. And my bed is a 150 kilo wooden bed, which is made out of one piece of wood. And it has two holes, one at the head and one at the feet. So the oil can actually come out, and I reuse that oil. So 1 liter of oil, I use it for an hour.
And that is to take and heal, and it takes all the cleansing. You said that all oils are good, and that we maybe don't appreciate how much oil is good for the body, no?
Yes.
For detoxing and...
Like in the Western world, we don't like oil. We don't eat it, we don't put it in our body. We almost like turned away from oil. But in India, we use a lot of oil. We use it on our skin, we use it in our mouths. Oil pulling, you know, takes the toxin away. We drip it in our nose, we eat it. Like, oil is so healing because actually all the toxin molecules get attached to that oil and it can come out of your body. Otherwise, it'll never come out.
Well, I'm sure the Spanish olive oil country is delighted to hear that. It's really lovely to chat with you, Valeria. I know you're very new to Marbella, relatively.
That's right.
How long have you been here?
6 months.
Oh,
I'm still a newbie.
Still a newbie, but I'm telling you, if you're a dog lover, this is a lady that you'll want to not only know and chat with, but it'll be more reason when you go for your treatments, you'll have a lot in common because you are, I'm a dog lover, but you're a dog fanatic.
That's right.
And you have white German shepherds like we
yes,
do.
Yes, like you do.
So the universe knows how to put the right people together. Valeria, I know we'll be seeing a lot more of you. Thank you so much and best of luck.
Thank you so much. Hey. It's a brand new day.
We're spoilt for choice of where to go out of an evening to wine and dine. However, due to the very strict drinking and driving laws and the fear of those controls, we frequently stay very close to home. Now, Aunt Lily's been wanting to go to the much acclaimed Takumi for a while, but she lives in Alveria, and that's the centre of Marbella. But thanks to the new safety first policy by Linea Director, she decided that she would venture out because if she needed to, she could put the policy into practice. And that's exactly what happened. Lily and Tom had an absolutely fabulous dinner at Takumi, so much so that when it got time to go home and Lily realised that her one glass of wine had already probably put herself over the limit, they decided to stay and carry on enjoying the evening, knowing that all they had to do was ring Linea Director's special number for their safety first policy and they would send a taxi at no charge to pick her and Tom up and take them home back to Alveria, and at the same time, as Lily wanted, their car was taken on a tow truck back home as well. Now, why does Linea Director offer this free extra service included in their policy? Well, prevention is certainly cheaper than cure, and they want to make sure that they live up to their name, putting your safety first and catering to expats' needs. This policy is only available to expats with their NIE,
with their residency number and only for the province of Malaga, but you can use it up to 4 times a month. All this is an addition to the special features that Linea Directa already offer their clients. As a Spanish company, they cater to all the legal local laws that are necessary when driving in Spain. They also have a fleet of tow trucks, mechanics, hotels, lawyers, anything you need to make sure you are safe and truly covered. All the documentation is in English, they have helplines in English, so everything is easy to understand. Linea Directa really is putting your safety first. If you'd like more information on insuring your car with Linea Directa, you can call them on 952 14 78 34. That's 952 14 78 34. And they'll answer all your questions in English. And of course, you can go to the website www.lineadirector.com.
So you're a business on the Costa del Sol, and you know the best way to reach customers is through word of mouth. But how can you reach more people to grow your business even faster? Before you spend a lot of money on advertising that may never reach your customers, find out how MarbellaFamilyFun.com can help spread the word about your business today. MarbellaFamilyFun.com.
A very good evening to you. Welcome back to the Legal Beagle segment here on Marbella Now. Now, in a change to the proposed billing for this week, we're going to carry on where we left off last week. And if you remember, we were talking about the High Court decision on whether the government could invoke Article 50 without a Parliament debate. It's all part of the Brexit madness that seems to be going on in the United Kingdom. And you would indeed be forgiven for thinking, if you looked at the newspaper headlines in the UK last week, that the world had gone mad. Well, let's just do a slight recap, shall we? Last June, or earlier this year in June, the United Kingdom voted by 52 to 48 to leave the European Union in a referendum. Since then, we've seen Prime Minister David Cameron resign, we've seen various changes in government, and Theresa May said at the party conference for the Conservative Party this summer that she intended to invoke Article 50, which is this magical resignation from the European Union, by March 2017. Now, as I explained last week, the case found its way to the High Court, and this was nothing really to do with Brexit, and I'll cover that in a second. But the government were taken to court on the basis of something called the royal prerogative. So let's start with that. Let's explain a couple of things about the UK constitution before we go on to the court's decision. The United Kingdom, unlike many other countries, doesn't have a written constitution as such. We have acts of parliament which are made by parliament, by the elected members of parliament, and which can be made and unmade only by Parliament. So if Parliament wants to make a law or pass an act of Parliament which becomes law, it has to debate it, and then the whole of Parliament, everybody's elected MP, has to vote on whether that becomes law. If everybody votes against it, the act doesn't become law. It's really that simple. Now, there's another thing that we need to explain as well, and that's the royal prerogative. The royal prerogative is something like this. Hundreds of years ago, before the United Kingdom had a parliament, the monarch could pretty much do as he chose in terms of running the country. He could make decisions, change this, do that, and with total impunity, because he was the monarch and it was his prerogative as the ruler of the country to do as he saw fit. Now, throughout the years, because of various revolutions, the Civil War in England with Oliver Cromwell, the royal prerogative has become a part of government's actions. And in many ways, it's actually very sensible. Government can use the royal prerogative when dealing with international relations, treaties, this kind of thing. It means that if you elect a government, they can deal with certain matters without putting them in front of Parliament. Going to war, for example, although in the last war you remember that Tony Blair put a vote through Parliament. So, when this matter came to court, one side was saying to the government, hold on, you cannot use the royal prerogative in these circumstances, because what you're doing is changing an act of parliament, and that was the 1973 European Communities Act. So you're taking that away without asking parliament. And the claimants, the people bringing the case, said you can't do that. The government, on the other hand, robustly defended that, saying, well, of course we can do that, we're Her Majesty's government. And in this situation, we had a referendum, it was voted on that the UK should leave the European Union, so we can invoke Article 50. So, what did the court say? Well, the three highest judges in the land examined the matter. And what they said, first of all, and they were keen to highlight this, was the court was not concerned with the merits of leaving the European Union. This is vitally important. This case had nothing to do with the merits of leaving the European Union. They said the question is, can the government use the royal prerogative to invoke Article 50? And what they did is they examined the facts. They said, look, on the 1st of January 1973, the UK Parliament voted to enact the European Communities Act, which basically made us join what was then the European Community. So it was an act of Parliament that was voted on by MPs and passed into law. So 20, 30 years later, we found ourselves in a situation where Britain's voted to leave the European Union and the government wished to invoke Article 50, this resignation letter. What the court said, though, is that the government could not do this without passing it through Parliament. Why? Because they would have to get rid of the European Communities Act of 1973 before they could invoke Article 50. So Parliament would, of course, have to vote on it. So the decision was that the government cannot exercise its prerogative powers where that will override an act of Parliament, and Parliament must decide. In essence, in an absolute nutshell, what the court was underlining was that if you elect a member of Parliament, those members of Parliament have every right to vote on a situation where the government can take away your rights. In this case, these are the rights that you have with being a part of the European Union. So as you can see, there's absolutely nothing in that decision that blocks Brexit. And we've heard in the news that there are going to be 100,000 people marching behind Nigel Farage on the UK Parliament, the UK Supreme Court when the case comes there, and various other issues and difficulties. But at the base of it all, we quite simply have a court judgment that said that, and I reiterate, the UK government cannot take away people's rights without putting that through their elected MPs and having them voting on it. It's pretty simple. What's it going to do to Brexit? Absolutely no one knows. The only thing that you can say for sure is that any plans to leave the European Union will have to be ratified and signed off by the United Kingdom Parliament, and that is that. Next week, we will get back onto traffic fines. But until then, if you have any questions whatsoever, patrick.charles.grant@gmail.com. Have a cracking weekend. We'll see you next time. Take care.
This next section is sponsored by Linea Director, tailored-made expat car insurance. I'm standing here by the A7. Traffic is always up and down on this road. It's the main road that takes us anywhere we want to go on our 27 kilometres of coastline that make up Marbella. However, a lot of you seem to not read when you're driving, and there are certain things we need to be taking notice of, and that is, for example, our speed limit signs. Let's go back to basics. When you see a sign, a round one like this, with a red circle, and in the middle there's a number, for example, 40, it means don't go more than 40 kilometers an hour. When you see a sign that says 80, guess what? That means do not go over 80 kilometers an hour. It's not a minimum speed, it's a maximum. And along our stretch of 27 kilometers of Marbella, it will go from 80 to 40, 60, 120. You need to pay attention to the recommended obligatory speed limits. Why? Because like here, turning off at the Nueva Andalucía, cars come on, they come off. If you're speeding more, then you won't be able to stop and they won't have room to get onto the street. And unfortunately, although this area looks impossible to cross the road, tourists will try and do that. They will climb over the barriers, they'll run across the road, hang out in the middle, and then run the extra bit. And if you're speeding, particularly at night time, they won't judge how far away you are, and you will end up running someone over. So please, please, back to basics. You see a speed limit, please pay attention.
Valle San Pedro. Today's sign is...
The nicest thing about recording a show in Marbella, about the people behind the scenes in Marbella, the people who really make Marbella tick, is I get to meet some fascinating people, and every week we get new ideas for different things to include in the programme. Well, a couple of weeks ago, a young student from the Lauda International School San Pedro Rowan came with her teacher Surian into the Mi Marbella radio studios. And I learned something from this young lady. She's a self-taught girl who knows how to do sign language. And she learned it because she had a deaf friend. So she thought it would be great to learn that language and communicate with her friend. And I think it's a great idea, so much so that Rowan and Lauda San Pedro have agreed that every week Rowan will do a little message. And if you know what that message is, you can win a great prize. So tune in next week and start getting practicing on your...
The answer was, welcome back to school from your midterm break.
Sometimes, when you've got so much going on and so much to do, you don't know where to start, the best thing is to completely stop and do what I did this past weekend, and that was go for an art lesson with the one and only Debbie Lush. Hello, Debbie.
Thank you, Nicole.
Thank you. I did like 4.5 hours that I thought about nothing else except what the teacher was going to say.
But you were a wonderful student, Nicole, I have to say.
Well, I do like to paint, but obviously to get to the calibre of someone like you, doesn't matter what style you put your hand to, Debbie, you are just... amazing.
I do try and change it as much as possible and be very versatile. And in this instance, I've used palette knife and oil painting. But I also do a lot of brushwork as well.
You do still life, which for me is like the hardest thing to even
begin. It can be tricky.
And you do pouring wine. In fact, your movement, the way you capture movement is quite special.
It's nice when I'm doing a wine bottle painting, pouring it into the glass to get the flow. That's kind of important.
Just keep tasting it.
It does drive me to drink sometimes.
When we saw you last time, you were presenting an almost erotic collection of artwork. So really, your variety is...
That was the 50 Shades of Marbella collection, which is kind of niche market, if you like, and very erotic. But I'm doing some new works now, and this is one of them. This is called Into the Sunset. And it's really to brighten up people's homes, and when they look at the painting, to make them feel relaxed and tranquil.
Well, you do feel that looking at your artwork, and I have to say that taking part in the class as well. Can other people join in your art classes? I really can't wait for next weekend. I had such a great time.
So that was a workshop, and I'm running these workshops every month, and people come along. It doesn't matter if you've never painted before, or perhaps you did it maybe 10 years ago, or perhaps you're painting on a weekly basis. It's for beginners to improvers. Both young adults can come, teenagers and adults. And we pick a painting, in this case it was the boat, and we start from the beginning. And at the end of the day, you're leaving your workshop with a finished piece of art that you've
made yourself.
And that
is lovely, because I got to take my artwork home. It's still wet, the oil paint takes a long time. But with you, I found it was wonderful because you explained the mixing of colours.
Yeah.
So without a doubt, I can highly recommend a de-stressing moment. Not only is she fun and lovely to be around, I'm very happy to have become friends with you over these months in tonight, but through her fabulous art. Debbie, thank you.
Thank you, Nicole.
I love going to the theatre. We don't have that much theatre here in Marbella, so when there are performances being put on, we want to be a part of them. And that's why Kate Jackson is back with us on the programme, and joined this time by Martin, a little fellow. Good thing he's sitting down. It goes on forever. So Kate, let's start with you, Martin. What performance are we going to be seeing this time?
This is Going Green, which is a political tragedy. And I'm
very appropriate.
Tragic comedy.
It's very of the moment, all about green issues and also political upheaval. So it's going to be a very interesting performance.
And when's it being held? Where is it? Tell us a bit more.
It's the 18th, 19th and 20th of November in the Atalaya Park Hotel Theatre Disco.
OK, Kate, tell us a bit about how you chose the subject for this performance and the people in it.
Sure. Well, I'm always on the lookout for a play that captures the moment, and this play certainly does. It is actually a tragic comedy with a political theme, but the laughs come and so do the tears. And I think that's what people want when they come to see a play. It's a really good combination. One minute people will laugh, the next minute they'll be crying. So we wanted to choose something also that was a bit different, because there are only so many plots, you know, boy meets girl sort of thing. And this was so different because it brought in, let's face it, political times, they're very much on everyone's lips at the moment.
Without a doubt. Martin, what part are you playing in this?
I play John Brown, who is the leader of the Green Party, and it's all about his life during the, or leading up to the election.
And what are you in your everyday life, a lawyer or something very serious?
No, I deal with holiday lettings in Estepona.
Oh, well, that's a fun thing to do as well, get to meet all those tourists.
Absolutely.
So tell us a bit about, for people who haven't seen you before, Kate, what is ITS, International Theatre?
Yeah, ITS is the International Theatre Studio. Based around Marbella, San Pedro, we want to bring theatre, English-speaking theatre, to the coast. We've been doing it actually since the 80s, so there's a lot of experience there. We're enthusiastic amateurs and we really enjoy what we do, and we want everyone to get involved. We're always looking for people backstage, for people to act. So International Theatre, we hope, really brings something different to the coast for people to come along and to watch.
Well, it's we're looking forward to it. As I say, we do have English theatre here in Marbella. All you have to do is go along to Atalaya. Where can we get the tickets, Kate?
You can, can I give a telephone number?
Of course you can.
You can call 952-880-240. There are several outlets along the coast, but it's too boring really to reel everyone off. It's a bit much. So go on the website. We have a really good interactive website. You can go on there and you can find out all the outlets where you can buy tickets. Or, Nicole, just turn up on the night and you can pay on the door.
And how much is it?
It's €12.
Well, very reasonable.
Oh, we think so.
Very reasonable. So, Kate, Martin will be performing in Going Green. We've put the perfect green background here in the local. I mean, what a perfect backdrop. And go along to the theatre. And if you want to get involved, contact Kate. Thanks, guys. Break a leg.
Thanks for having us, Nicole. Hope you'll come and see us.
I will.
Hey, hey, it's a brand new day.
Hello, my name is Colin Turner. You might have seen me before on this show with Nicole talking about my book F Day, and I was on the radio the other day talking about Into the Open Economy. I'd like to, Nicole mentioned to me before about the United Nations Nationalities of Marbella Now and the summit that's coming up in April. So I thought I'd like to give you maybe some ideas, maybe over the next few weeks, of how we can all create more inclusive communities, how we can all help each other better to create lives better for everybody. So over the next couple of weeks, I'm going to give you just a few different hints and ideas that we can use in preparation for this summit in April, which should be fantastic. I'll be talking about things like creating inclusive communities and dissolving differences and divisions between races and culture, and realizing that our commonness is more important than our differences. I'll be suggesting some ideas for community sharing initiatives, ideas where we can all actually leverage our each other as a resource to actually improve our own lives and help get the things we need. I can show you why community sharing is better, why it can actually help you save money, and also feel better and feel healthier and happier in the process. So everything is positive about it. If we just, it's all about shifting our focus from self-interest to group interest, and moving in towards the summit in April. So that's it. I'm going to keep you updated over the next few weeks with just some different ideas to help improve lives and to help work together better and to be happier.
Hey, hey, it's a brand new.
We're on our 99th programme, and what goes around comes around. One of the very first shows we had the honour of welcoming Desi Egan to the programme. He sang live for us in the studio. And today you're back here in Marbella. Welcome home.
Thank you very much. Great to be back again. Thank you, Nicole.
You are a very big name in Ireland. You've performed before and with some of the most emblematic stars of the last three decades,
yeah,
really.
Yeah, we have, yeah. Yes, been very fortunate.
Where did you start off your music career, Desi?
Well, I studied music when I was quite young and developed from that, and I ended up becoming a music producer. And that took me in then to producing shows for some of these artists that used to tour. So when I was required to put a band together for that artist, I used to MD the show. So I'd be actually playing keyboards and I'd be arranging all the music for the bands and for the artists. So I became very friendly with a lot of singers. And then it moved from that into recording studios, so I started producing records. Then I started doing a little bit of backing harmonies in the records, because sometimes there might be a singer available and say, well, I'll fill in on that little spot there because this guy didn't turn up to sing that. So it developed my vocals, and then later on then I started recording some songs. So that's the full spectrum of how I basically started from being a keyboard player to a singer.
For the sunshine sky, and there's a reason why I'm feeling so high. Must be the season when that love light shines all around us. So let that feeling grab you deep inside and send you reeling where your love can't hide, and maybe stealing through the moonlit nights with your lover.
I love soul, 70s and 80s soul music. I grew up in that era when Earth, Wind and Fire and Bobby Brown and Barry White and Lou Rawls and all that type of disco 70s music and Chic and bands like that were big names when I was a kid. And I love that orchestrations of the music and the Philadelphia sound and all this stuff. And it really was really lovely as a musician to listen to. So when I started doing my own music, I started to record some of the old 70s classic hits, which we have coming out on an album in February.
Wow.
So there's about 7 or 8 big classic songs from the 70s in there. You to Me Are Everything, and One from The Real Thing. And then Young Hearts Run Free is on
that. That's your new kind of release, your
new
single.
That's coming out. And then I have a song which we have a clip for called Let Your Love Flow, which is a Bellamy Brothers song. And so that type of music covers basically all our era of music that my age group kind of listens to be honest. So I kind of says, well, I like that stuff. And I think I'll get a chance now to record songs I like doing. Instead of playing songs, maybe I would have worked with bands I mightn't have sometimes liked some of the music, unfortunately, that I was playing. Well, you get paid to play. That's what they say in the music business.
It's a hard business that you got into, to make a career of a musician. So all I can say is congratulations.
Thank you very, very
for
much.
For, like, got this far.
Yeah, yeah.
I believe...
Fantastic to be in Marbella and on your show, Nicola, and have the support I have from the locals here.
You're planning on coming back, I believe, actually look at maybe doing a few gigs here.
We will. We definitely will. And I'm over and back quite a lot because I've... We have a management team here in base now, and they're putting me into some smaller venues starting off.
Is that just with Graham that
with
we met
Graham,
on the radio?
Yeah, yeah, he's going to put me into some of the nice restaurants and nice hotel type work, cabaret type work I'm going to be doing from probably February and March next year.
Well, we look forward to that.
Absolutely, thank you very much. I'm looking forward to seeing you all, and hopefully you can come and see us.
Like a mountain stream, and let your love grow with the smallest of dreams, and let your love show. And you know what I mean, it's the season. Just let your love fly like a bird on the wing, and let your love bind you to all living things, and let your love shine. And you know what I mean, that's the reason.
Well, that's it for another week. Thank you so much for joining us for our 99th MarbellaNOW. Thank you so much to Seb and Alexis for welcoming us here to the local. Thanks so much to my friend Fiona from back when for introducing us to our kids growing up. I would never have recognized them. Desi coming all the way from Ireland to be part of this show. Thanks to all our guests. Thanks to you for watching. Take care of yourselves. Be nice to each other, please. And hopefully we'll see you again next week. Bye.
Like you've missed it. You dropped out.